Tokyo Olympics this year coincided with some soul-bearing documentaries about the mental hurdles elite athletes face as they compete. One of these is The Weight of Gold, a documentary executive produced by the unequaled Olympic swimmer Michael Phelps. The film shines a light on the serious and sometimes fatal mental health struggles that top athletes go through. The recently released Netflix documentary, Naomi Osaka reveals the Japanese mixed-race tennis phenomenon as someone who, despite amazing successes, struggles with self-doubt. Of course, you don't have to be an Olympian to struggle with mental health and self-doubt. The COVID pandemic has made millions more vulnerable. We have all struggled under lockdown, and many of us feel anxiety as society starts to open up again. Peter, our Bible hero that we're looking at today, struggled with a lack of self-discipline as well as unhealthy self-doubt. The Bible goes into quite a bit of detail, telling us about both the successes and failures of Peter. In many ways, he's a relatable kind of guy. His story shows us that God can do amazing things when we stop doubting ourselves. Over 2 billion people around the world believe in the Bible and God's power to change lives for the better. We are studying the story of Jesus' disciple Peter by reading the Bible and a beautiful book about Jesus and his followers by Ellen G. White called The Desire of Ages. Smithsonian Magazine named Ellen White, who we'll call Ellen for short, among the 100 most significant Americans of all time. Although she lived over 100 years ago, Ellen is the most translated female nonfiction author in the history of literature, and is also the most translated American nonfiction author of either gender. If you would like your own free copy of Desire of Ages, you can download it at hopetv.org/at-home. You can say what you want about Peter, but you cannot say that he was boring. He had an explosive, impulsive personality that at times made him a hero and at other times landed him in a heap of trouble. Perhaps more than any other disciple, Peter wore his feelings and insecurities on his sleeve. Let's check out one of the best-known Bible stories about Peter. It comes right after the account of Jesus feeding over 5,000 people that had gathered at the beach to hear him. We'll pick up things in Matthew 14, verse 22, where Jesus tells his disciples he needs some alone time. Immediately, Jesus made the disciples get into the boat and go on ahead of him to the other side, while he dismissed the crowd. After he had dismissed them, he went up on a mountainside by himself to pray. Later that night, he was there alone, and the boat was already a considerable distance from the land, buffeted by the waves because the wind was against it. The book of Matthew covers a lot of ground in just a few verses here. It's easy to miss just how scary things were out on that night on that lake. Let's see how Ellen elaborates on the predicament of the disciples as they found themselves on the water. A violent tempest had been stealing upon them, and they were unprepared for it. It was a sudden contrast, for the day had been perfect. And when the gale struck them, they were afraid. Everyone worked to keep the boat from sinking. It was but a short distance by sea from Bethsaida to the point where they expected to meet Jesus. And in ordinary weather, the journey required but a few hours. But now they were driven further and further from the point they sought. Until the fourth watch of the night, they toiled at the oars. Then the weary men gave themselves up for lost. In storm and darkness, the sea had taught them their own helplessness, and they longed for the presence of their master. The story of this dramatic boat journey is so true to life. We all know what it's like to go from a huge emotional high to feeling like we've been kicked to the curb in a space of a few moments. The contrast stuns us. It often feels unfair. What just happened? We ask ourselves. The disciples have just experienced the incredible feeding of the 5,000. The power of God had been on full display. His ability to provide was staring them in the face. But right on the heels of experiencing God's help, the disciples of Jesus are plunged into despair as they think they're about to die. Let's see what happens next, starting in verse 25 of Matthew 14. Shortly before dawn, Jesus went out to them, walking on the lake. When the disciples saw him walking on the lake, they were terrified. "It's a ghost," they said, and cried out in fear. But Jesus immediately said to them, "Take courage. It is I. Don't be afraid." Ellen gives us some context for how the disciples are coping at this part of their boat journey. At the moment when they believe themselves lost, a gleam of light reveals a mysterious figure approaching them upon the water. But they know, but they know not that it is Jesus. The one who has come for their help, they count as an enemy. Terror overpowers them. The hands that have grasped the oars with muscles like iron let go of their hold. The boat rocks at the will of the waves. All eyes are riveted on this vision of a man walking upon the white-capped billows of the foaming sea. They think it's a phantom that omens their destruction, and they cry out in fear. Jesus advances as if he would pass them, but they recognize him and cry out, entreating his help. Their beloved master turns, his voice silences their fear. "Be of good cheer, it is I, do not be afraid." Take a moment to put yourself in the boat with the disciples. Adrenaline is pumping through their body. You are doing all you can to stabilize the boat. Your fear of the storm escalates to sheer terror when you think you've seen a ghost who then claims to be Jesus. What do you do next? Peter has always been a little crazy and decides the best thing to do at this point is ask for permission to walk out on the water to join Jesus. After all, he's a disciple, and the goal of a disciple is not just to say what the rabbi says. The goal of a disciple is to do what a rabbi does. And if his rabbi is walking on water, that means that Peter needs to put himself in a situation where he will also walk on water. So while everyone else is shaking with astonishment, Peter calls out. Continuing with the Bible passage, we hear Peter's request. "Lord, if it is you," Peter replied, "tell me to come to you on the water." "Come," he said. Then Peter got down out of the boat, walked on the water, and came toward Jesus. But when he saw the wind, he was afraid, and beginning to sink, cried, "Lord, save me." Immediately, Jesus reached out his hand and caught him. "You of little faith," he said, "why did you doubt?" And when they climbed into the boat, the wind died down. Then those who were in the boat worshiped him, saying, "Truly, you are the Son of God." Let's try to understand what was going on in Peter's head throughout this experience. It's not all bad. At first, Jesus rewards Peter's bold request to walk on water. It takes a special kind of person to even make that kind of ask. Ellen describes Peter's elation right before he steps out of the boat and explains what follows. Peter was almost beside himself with joy, as if he would scarcely yet believe. He cried out, "Lord, if it is you, command me to come to you on the water." And he said, "Come." Looking unto Jesus, Peter walks securely. But as in self-satisfaction, he glances back toward his companions in the boat, his eyes are turned from the Savior. The wind is boisterous, the waves roll high and come directly between him and the Master, and he is afraid. For a moment, Christ is hidden from his view, and his faith gives way. He begins to sink. But while the billows talk with death, Peter lifts his eyes from the angry waters and, fixing them upon Jesus, cries, "Lord, save me." Immediately, Jesus grasps the outstretched hand, saying, "Oh, you of little faith, why did you doubt?" At first, Peter is overconfident when Jesus gives him the go-ahead to come meet him on the water. He takes his first few steps and all goes well. Petrified, just moments later, Peter is now feeling pretty good about himself. This walking on water stuff isn't hard after all. Peter glances beyond him to make sure his friends are watching his amazing skills. I bet you guys are jealous now, he thinks to himself with more than a hint of smugness. But turning away from Jesus, he becomes consumed with his own performance. His focus turns to himself, and as often as it happens with us in life, pride and ego gives way to self-doubt and insecurity. Peter is distracted again by the insane storm that is tossing the boat around. Focused on himself, he is filled with self-doubt and fear as he sinks in the water. God can do amazing things when we stop doubting ourselves and start trusting him. The only problem was Peter was doing the opposite. He was both doubting himself and forgetting who it was that had enabled him to walk on water. When Jesus pulls Peter out of the water and asks him why he doubted, the passage does not record a response from the disciple that otherwise was known as a loudmouth. Peter had been humbled. And only God is able to humble us without humiliating us. Ellen says, walking side by side, Peter's hand in that of his master, they stepped into the boat together. But Peter was now subdued and silent. He had no reason to boast over his fellows, or through unbelief and self-exaltation, he had very nearly lost his life. When he turned his eyes from Jesus, his footing was lost and he sunk amid the waves. Let's not be too hard on Peter. His mistake on the lake is one that we all make. If we take our focus off Jesus and instead just think about ourselves, our accomplishments, our abilities, it's only a matter of time until the mind drifts to the failures and weaknesses as well. Then self-doubt kicks in and we end up sabotaging ourselves. God can do amazing things when we stop doubting ourselves, but it's hard to experience the confidence and calm we need to succeed in God's mission if we continue to be self-absorbed. God alone can give us the power to stop doubting ourselves and instead step out in faith. Ellen explains it like this. When trouble comes upon us, how often we are like Peter. We look upon the waves instead of keeping our eyes fixed upon the Savior. Our footsteps slide and the proud waters go over our souls. Jesus did not bid Peter come to him that he should perish. He does not call us to follow him and then forsake us. Fear not, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by your name. You are mine. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you. And through the rivers, they shall not overflow you. When you walk through the fire, you shall not be burned, nor shall the flame scorch you. For I am the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, your Savior, says Isaiah 43:1-3. God can do amazing things when we stop doubting ourselves, but we aren't supposed to take this truth as license to go around showing off our abilities. We wouldn't have any of those abilities without God. They are all gifts from above. God expects us to use them for good, but he doesn't mean that we can get big-headed about what God allows us to do. Many of us make this mistake. We think that our gifts and abilities and our time, we are giving to God what we have that is ours and is best. Your gifts and abilities are not your gifts to God. It's the opposite. It's God's gifts to you. He allowed you to have experiences from childhood that enabled you to have those gifts and talents. It is his gift to you. Jesus let Peter have his humbling experience because he knew Peter would have learned from it. Like all of us, Peter was a work in progress. Peter may have been dripping wet as he got back on the boat, but he was more mature. He had learned how to use the power God gave him. And he had also learned how easily he could stumble without a focus on Jesus. Ellen reflects on the experience, saying, day by day, God instructs his children. By the circumstances of the daily life, he's preparing them to act their part upon that wider stage to which his providence has appointed them. It is the issue of the daily test that determines their victory or defeat in life's great crisis. Those who fail to realize their constant dependence upon God will be overcome by temptation. We may now suppose that our feet stand secure and that we all shall never be moved. We may say with confidence, I know in whom I have believed. Nothing can shake my faith in God and in His Word. But Satan is planning to take advantage of our hereditary and cultivated traits of character and to blind our eyes to our own necessities and defects. Only through realizing our own weakness and looking steadfastly upon Jesus can we walk securely. Elite athletes know the extreme importance of the mental game in sports. They know that unless they can approach their sport with calm confidence, they are done for. What goes on in their heads will directly affect their performance in competition. Similarly, we as believers in God have to remember the spiritual battle that rages day in and day out in our lives. How we approach this battle is a life or death matter. God longs for us to choose Him and to make the best of the exceptional abilities and gifts He has given us. God can do amazing things when we stop doubting the gifts He has blessed us with. Pray with me. Dear Heavenly Father, I pray that You will bless each person that is listening to this message and contemplating Your Word and the story of Peter. Lord, we pray for courage to ask to get out of the boat, and once we start walking on water, that we will not doubt ourselves nor Your power to fulfill Your purpose. Give us humility and competence. We pray in the name of Jesus. Amen.